Good afternoon. So I am Philippe Laurent. I am from CEA and APC laboratory in Paris. And Anatoly asked me to present you a small historical panorama of gamma ray burst polarization measurement. In fact, I work mostly on the integral satellite, so most of my presentation will be devoted to integral. But okay, I will discuss about other mission also. A few words about the principle that you have heard already many times now. We use Compton scattering to measure polarization. So you have two planes, two detectors, one incident photon, make a Compton scattering, and then the scattered photon made some deposit here. And this repartition here, this distribution, is not homogeneous if the signal is polarized. It has a certain distribution which is given by this formula. And by looking at this distribution in real data, we can get the polarization property. In particular, we can get from the minimum of the distribution the polar angle, the polarimetric angle, and the fraction of polarization with this A factor here. What it should be known is that for a given detector, if you have a 100% polarized source, you will not have a 100% modulation in your data. So there is a factor, what we call A100, which is the modulation for a 100% polarized source, which depends on the material and the configuration. Could be from 10 to 90%. There is another way to make polarization measurement, as it was indicated by Peter before and also by Sergei for GammaScope. You can also study Compton event in one detector. If you have some pixel and good energy resolution, you can study the distribution of scattered photon around the incident photon. It's what I will call 19-degree scattering polarization. So that's the plan of my little history of GRB polarization. The first measurement we can think of is a RACI measurement about polarization of a gamma ray burst. I will speak only of polarization of gamma ray burst, not polarization of X-ray binaries or solar flare or other celestial source. Now the present, we will have the integral result and the very recent GAP result, Japanese. And the future, I will speak a bit about the next generation polarimeter. So the RACI observation, so RACI was a, maybe I couldn't move, was made with a spectrometer, which was devoted mainly to study solar activity and solar flare and solar spectroscopy and solar nuclear line, which is induced in solar flare. It was launched in 2002, and it was composed here of 9 germanium detectors, which was at 80 key temperature. And there were, in front of these 9 detectors, a modulated coded mask to do some imaging of the sun. As I said before, this kind of detector can make some sort of 90-degree polarization measurement by studying, for instance, one photon which makes a Compton scattering in this detector and then is absorbed by this one. And there have been some simulation of the signal, the polarimetric signal we can have from that. Here you have the distribution of the azimuthal angle, as we have shown before, in degree, and the count. And you see that we can have modulation quite big, up to 40%. So RACI observed in 2002 a gamma ray burst, which was called GRB02126, because it was observed in 6 December 2002. And it was a very, very bright GRB detected up to 2 MeV. And that's the light curve measured by RACI from 25 to 150 and then up to 2 MeV. And Cobbard and Box has published in Nature in 2003 a claim that they measure the polarization of this gamma ray burst in this energy band. To do so, quickly, they look at all the data in this light curve between 100 and kV and 2 MeV, and these data are put in bin in azimuthal angle. So the real data are here, is this cross you see there, which are repeated twice for clarity. And they made several Monte Carlo simulations of the detector in different conditions for a non-polarized source to see what could be the answer of the detector to a non-polarized source. This is with this square there, the diamond, sorry, the answer to a non-polarized source here. And what they did is to subtract the non-polarized to the polarized. And that's the result. And of course, clearly you can see a very clear sinusoidal signal. And then they claim that they detect polarization in that gamma ray burst. And it was a Nature paper. Unfortunately, 1 year later, the same data was reanalyzed in 2004 by Rutledge and Fox in a monthly notice, and they demonstrate that this detection was wrong. In fact, it was an artifact. In fact, there are several reasons why this was an artifact. The first one is that some of the double events used by Cobbard and Box to make the curve I showed you before was not real double events, that means two events seen in two different detectors, but they demonstrate that it was more or less the same event which was repeated twice by the electronics. So in fact, there are too much double events in their data set, and really too much, because in fact, they overestimate the number of double events by a factor 10, which is tremendous. So if you divide by 10 the number of events, of course, the signal to noise is diminishing. And in fact, you get merely the same signal, but with much, much more bigger error bar. And you see that your polarization signal that was clearly seen here, in fact, with bigger error bar, is completely dominated by systematics. And you cannot say if you see something or not. So,
Oui,
bien sûr.
You go back a moment.
Yeah.
It's always very confusing because actually the signal there is repeated to show the sinusoid.
Yes.
It stops at some point.
Yes, in fact, it's between 0 and 180 degrees. So it's a P periodic signal.
So if you remove half of the signal there,
yes.
Then you really what you catch with the eye without this model,
right?
Is different.
Right? Well, in fact,
the black point, what is the black point?
Which is that point here is a simulation one. That the real data are the cross.
Yeah.
Then they simulated a non-polarized source and made the subtraction. So what the point what you see there is the difference between this one and this one. It should be this, in fact, I hope. But, well, in fact, it's an artifact. But effectively, by high, you think there's something. That's
yeah, it's the model.
Is that a statistic?
Voilà. Statistic is complicated sometimes. So that has illustrated the difficulty of polarization data analysis. And it was really a problem because it puts suspicion on on polarization measurement up to now, because even now people say that what was seen by integral, by gap, by, is due to systematic in the same way as what was seen by Ricci. And also the second consequence, which is maybe less important, at least for non-English people, is that Nature now refuses any paper on polarization measurement because they have been they have a problem once and they don't want to.
Yes, exactly. I think they published other papers unrelated for this.
Ah, bah, voilà. So I'll go to Integral. So Integral is a satellite which has been built, say, managed by ESA, the European Space Agency. It's a very big satellite of 4 tons, 5 meters height, and it was launched in 2002, and it is still working, as we will celebrate the 10-year birthday, anniversary, maybe, because birthday for satellite.
Autumn, yes.
In autumn, yeah. There will be a special session in Paris to celebrate this, so you, if you wish to come, you can register. So there is two main instruments in Integral. There is IBIS, which is here. It's two coded mask instruments. You know now about coded mask instruments, thanks to Peter. And here is a coded mask, here is a detector, and here is a SPI telescope. This one is more an imager. He makes image of the sky. SPI is more a spectrometer. He has a very good spectroscopy property. And there is two monitors, an X-ray monitor, GMX, and optical monitor, so there is some optical monitor. Yeah.
But not operating.
It is operating, but it does not see.
Not
okay. Let's forget about it.
Yes.
And all the data go to the Integral Science Data Center in Switzerland. So I will present you the Integral IBIS GRB observation, and also the Integral SPI, because in fact, GRB polarization has been observed by the two telescopes. So this gives some confidence, because they are completely independent and they have similar results. So I will begin with IBIS and then SPI, and I will show you what we get about the result we get on this very bright gamma ray burst 04-12-19. So here is the IBIS telescope. I won't go very far. You have two detectors, two layers of detectors, so it's really a Compton telescope with two layers. You have a CDT layer, which is called ISGRI, and which was made by CEA. And there is a CSI layer, PIXIT, which was made by Italian people from Bologna. And all this is surrounded by an active anti-coincidence of BGO. And you have here a passive shield of tantalum, and above, up to the mask, 3 meters away that you don't see, the golden mask here, you have a passive shield of lead also. That's it. All this made a field of view of 15 degrees at zero response. So that is the total field at zero response is 29 degrees. So this...
So the mask was made
of
what?
Of lead. 11 millimeters of lead. No, it's pretty big. IBIS telescope, so it's a coded mass telescope, but also a Compton telescope, so we can mix the two imaging systems at the same moment. And this is very nice for polarization measurement. And what we define as a Compton event, because we have a special data event in IBIS, what we call Compton event is an event which are in coincidence between ISGRI and PIXIT in a given temporal window, because we cannot say a priori if it is a true Compton or not. And this temporal window is unfortunately quite high due to the response time of the CDT, which is quite high also. So there are a good chance within that window that a chance coincidence, a spurious coincidence occur. And this was one of the main problems we had in the data analysis. of EBs. Quickly, the ASAM factor, which A100, sorry, factor, which is a factor of modulation you get for a 100 polarized source, for EBs is around 0.3. And this was estimated in all time by Giant Free. But unfortunately, we don't have the time with integral to make on-ground calibration of polarization due to the tight planning. So I will go to explain you a bit the data analysis, trying to convince you that maybe we have seen really polarization after the RACI affair. Well, spurious event is an Isgree event, which is seen with an independent Pixit event in the, this given time window of 3 microseconds. So it's really a problem for us because this we did not expect before. It is a true Isgree event. So it could come from the source. It could be a low energy event coming from, for instance, sinus X1. What you take for a high energy event coming from sinus X1 is, in fact, a low energy event which comes from sinus X1, which, by chance, it's not a chance, but okay, is linked to a Pixit event. So why am I saying that? Because if it is, as it is a true source event, it has the mask signature. And that, when you make the condensed mask deconvolution, you keep this event because it is really a source event, but you are wrong on the flux of the source. That is, you overestimate the flux source by a big factor. So we had to take this into account. Sorry?
The window was only 2 microseconds?
No, it's 3.6. In fact, here, in fact, it's 3.9, because here, what is put is a half a window. I can explain to you afterwards, it's because right. You have one window from Isgree plus Pixit, and one window for Pixit plus Isgree. So it's the real time window is 3.8. Why?
So if you get a sharp, if you get a fast gamma reverse, you get much more.
Ah, this is not, well, this is true. That is, if you have something like an X-ray binary or things like that, which the source flux is quite low, it's a problem. If you have a very bright gamma reverse with a lot of photons coming in a small wind time window, we have no problem with these spurious sources, in fact. For gamma ray bursts, it's not a problem. Fine. So we have computed the spurious event contribution, and we have built fake event, taking one single event of the real observation randomly, and we had associated to one Pixit event of the same observation. And then we make all the data analysis, we compute the source flux, and we subtract this from the source flux obtained with the real data. This is it's not so important. It's just to say that we have to take into account the fact that for Compton imaging, Compton coded mass imaging, the image on the detector plane is not uniform, even if your detector is uniform. So you have to take this into account. If not, you have big problem with deconvolution. So once we have made all this, we deconvolve the shadowgram. That is, you know that in a coded mask imaging, each shadow, each type of shadow on the detector corresponds to a different direction in the sky. So by looking at the shadow, you know which direction it's come from. Coming from. So we look at the shadow and we say that, okay, it's coming from that direction. And if we select the event in 6 bin in azimuthal angle, we can compute the flux in this 6 bin and try to see if we see something or not with polarization. That's the crab polarization curve. And you see that we see a signal effectively from the crab polarization. this signal was confirmed afterward by SPI. But okay, CRAB is not a JRB, so I will go longer on CRAB. Maybe you will be interested in Pulsar afterward. But because in Pulsar, you have a good collaboration between optic and okay. Doesn't listen. We spend a long time, but really a long time, to check for systematics. And I have put some of the tests we made to show you. Because effectively, even if you have an unpolarized signal, you have some inhomogeneities on the pattern due to the modulation of the detector itself. The fact that we have square detectors, we have grids. Also in X-ray, I don't know if you could see this, but here you see you have these big things here, which induce some problem maybe. And we have the mass pattern and things like that. So we have checked first with strong calibration source to see that we have no signal, of course, with strong calibration source. And we put a limit on the order of 7%, say. If we look at a region with we have no source, so we have only the effect of the detector, we have also this limit of around 5-10%. There is some problem sometimes if the source that angle is big. For ISGRI, it was not so important because our field of view was quite small. But if the field of view is large, you can have some artifact due to the fact that the source is... the projection in the source is not in the plane of the detector. And also, we test the effect of spurious event. That's the result. They induce indeed a signal, a spurious event, but it's at 180 degrees polarization angle, and it's a very weak signal, in fact. So we put some systematic error on our result of about 10% each time. A word with SPI also, because in integral you have also the spectrometer. The spectrometer is made like RACI of a germanium detector, which are cooled down at 80 Kelvin. If I remember well, there is 19 of them here. And you can, it's always the same, you have a Compton scattering here. You look at the deposition in one detector and the other, you can have some idea of the polarization. It is much more difficult in SPI. I will not go into the detail. Because in fact, you cannot make with SPI a direct deconvolution. Because there are too few mask elements, with respect to the detector element, or too few detector elements with respect to the mask element. And for ISGRI, it's a direct computation which enables you to have the sky image from the detector image. For SPI, you have to use simulation and more complicated software. So they use a huge amount of simulation to find what is the response to a source like the CRAB with a given polarization angle and given polarization fraction, and so on and so forth. So I will pass this. Ah, but no, pas ça. And they feed the data to the CRAB data with their simulated data. And they use the background of SPI, the real background. And they found from the CRAB observation exactly the same result as the IBIS one, but I have not shown but, that. We see a very polarized signal in the 200 to 800 kV energy range, more than 60%, say, polarized, so it's very big. And the angle is 120 degrees, which is similar to the angle which is measured by optical polarization, because in optical it's very easy to measure the polarization, and they can map the polarization. You have the polarization angle at each distance from the pulsar, and in fact the value we found with integral was exactly the same within error that the one really in the pulsar itself. So we could say that in fact the gamma ray we found was not from the nebula around, but really in the pulsar region itself. In fact, in X-ray, in the whole time, Weisskopf measured the nebula and found 150, which is not consistent with our measurement, but which is consistent with optical measurement at a higher radius. So, in fact, we can say that in the crab case, optical, enfin, gamma ray come, polarized gamma ray come from the pulsar itself, and polarized X-ray come from the nebula. But okay, this is not Jabi, so I go back to Jabi. We studied the polarization of this gamma ray burst with integral. Why? Because, in fact, it's obvious, because it was the brightest we had in the field of view. And first, the integral spectrometer reports a high polarization level of 68% for this burst. And then we made also the study with IBIS to confirm this value we infirm. And what we made is we cut the light curve, that's the light curve of the pulsar, of the gamma ray burst, sorry. And we cut this light curve into elements of 10 seconds. In fact, it was so bright that we can have enough signal in a 10-second bin. Okay. In fact, it's not 5 seconds, it's 10-second bin, but it's 10 seconds which are moved by 5 seconds each time, so, okay. So that's the result in some of the bin. So as you can see here, this GRB has two peaks. So in the first peak, we found a signal which is consistent with nothing. And we could be confident that the level of systematic is not so big, because as you can see with the error bar, we are on the order of 10% effectively. The second peak, we see some modulation. But if you go deeper in the time analysis, you see that we see sometimes much larger much larger polarization signal. For instance, in that P30 time bin, which is the 30th time bin of the pulsar of gamma ray burst, we see a very strong signal, which has a very low chance to be by chance. And we measure the fraction and the angle at each time. By the way, P8 is the same moment as P. And that's the result. And you see that
can you just go back?
Oui, bien sûr.
So are these bins completely independent?
Which, what was?
These bins are completely independent?
Yes and no. In fact, adjacent bins are not completely independent, because we move, it's 10 second beam moved by 5 seconds each time. So two adjacent beams are 5 seconds in common. But if you take one bin here and one bin there, they're completely independent, yes.
And this is, the bottom is scattering angle in degrees.
Excuse me?
The bottom axis is scattering angle in degrees?
Yes, it's always the same. So. Except that, we, of course, as usual, we are repeated twice. So, in fact, the real value are the 6 points which are here. And then it's the same.
So, it says P equals 10 to the minus 4.
Wait,
so
yes.
That means it's 4 sigma?
No, it's more complicated than that. Because, in fact, I have not shown it here, but I have it if you wish. The probability law for detecting one given signal at one given pulsar, at one given polarimeter angle and fraction is a bit more complicated because these two quantities are not independent, the one from each other. So you have to consider the real independent factor, which are the stock value. And you should put the compute the CL to noise in function of the stock value and go back to this. So this probability is a probability to have by chance this signal without any condition on the angle. This one?
The right side.
Right side, yeah.
I guess it's consistent with zero.
Oui?
And also the upper left is unphysical because every point is.
But this is, in fact, you see the systematic we put, in fact. The statistical errors are smaller than that. So we put systematically some.
I put an artificial
time. Ouais.
Because it looks like the lower. Right.
Yes.
So that means that your 10% is overestimated.
Yes. Well, we have no idea what could be. Well, we have some idea because we made some measurements, but we put 10% because we were sure that it was an overestimate.
But if your chi squared is lower than
from this, we can we.
Hmm. Wait.
No, but it's the only case when you have such a bright signal. It's the only case where we have such a very clean signal. So it is it's the only case where it is dominated by systematics. In most of the study we made, we have not enough statistics.
Well, here, yes, on the lower right side.
Yeah, that's possible, yes.
So your chi-square must be lower than
mine. Right. But we take some care. Yeah, you know, it's always the same story. People are so reluctant to see this result, but we have to, we add to add too much error, in fact, I think. So you see here that during the duration of the gamma ray burst, the fraction is varying and the angle also is varying. So we have published this in the GOST paper. But in fact, during a gamma ray burst, the polarization angle may vary. And this was confirmed by GAP. I will talk about it later. And in fact, the SPI value, which are there, 70 and 63, if I am not wrong, are consistent with our value in the same time bin. So you can use gamma ray bursts to make some constraint on fundamental physics also. So with that we try. That is, we try to put some constraint of Lorentz invariance violation with gamma ray bursts. And in fact, if you have Lorentz invariance violation, you expect that you have a rotation of the polarization angle between the source and you in different energy bands. And the rotation is not the same for the different energy bands, so you should see a delta in the rotation. This is not a new idea. It was already studied by Machon et al. With the SPI measurement of the crab, and they get a limit on this effect by seeing no rotation, of course, of 10 minus 9 in some unit. I will come back to that. The principle, quickly, is that instead of writing a light dispersion relation of that that order, you had another higher order term, which depends on Planck mass. And in fact, the effect of the invariance, Lorentz invariance violation, is given by this xi parameter here. If this xi parameter here is zero, of course, you come back to the normal way of light propagation.
There's a
vacuum polarization. Oui, exactly. And this could be positive and negative, so it induces, at the end, a certain rotation, which is proportional to the xi factor, and also, which is important, to the distance. So the further you go, the more you can should see this rotation of the polarization angle between two energy bands. So the Machion result was 2 10 to the minus 9 for this value, which was already very good compared to what the measurement made on Earth, which are of the order of 1.1 10 minus 2, something like that. And for CRB, we are at least 10 times further, so we can put a greater constraint. So we made a distance determination with the VIRCAM camera in the Canadian French Hawaiian telescope, which is an infrared camera. And we measured the redshift. Unfortunately, it was not so good. No. Big, and as you see, we have a big error bar on Z. So we cannot have a very good distance value. And so, of course, if we have a bright gamma ray burst with a better distance determination, it will be great for us. But it's what we have.
In the end, this measurement is very difficult because you don't have a focus. You don't have a small position error.
No. Well, yeah. Fine. Oui. Yes. And in fact, the source was not so strong in the infrared, so the infrared measurement was very complicated.
Can you come back to one? This is effect depends on the length of the energy or not?
Ah, this rotation?
Yeah.
But normally, if you have no invariance violation, it does not depend. But now, if you suppose that there is violation of the variance, it depends.
It's I what don't we understand how to use this effect.
But,
because you do not know the real polarization angle.
No, but you can compare two energy bands, is what
yes,
we said.
Two different lengths.
It's what I have shown here.
Light to dispersion measure.
Voilà, exactly.
Yes.
So you have here one energy band, another energy band, and you compare the signal in the two bands. And you see that the two are at the 95% level comparable. You see that we can see here that, how can I say, this representation in function of the polarization angle and polarization fraction is not Gaussian, justly because it's not two independent parameters. That's why we have this kind of figure, and so it's not so easy to figure out.
Excuse me.
Oui, oui.
Is it can you say about the same like the Faraday rotation? No confusion with this. In
no.
Gamma ray.
No, because you have no.
Yeah,
well, this one. Additional question for very small. How to separate, because the distance is very large from the gamma ray burst source, how to separate vacuum polarization and the effect of matter on the
light of Faraday?
Yes, light of Faraday and other matter effects. How would it be separated?
But, in fact, What I can say is that we see no effect. If we have seen an effect, effectively we should have looked at this before having a Nobel Prize. We should check that effectively. Voilà, exactly. And we compute this also during the whole light curve, so we add 5 points of delta theta, which are given there. And then it allows us to put some value of this xi parameter, which is, for the moment, the best value ever found for this kind of Lorentz invariance violation constraint. And in fact, we publish that, and so some quantum theory does not was not consistent with that, but we learn afterward of a few months that they modify their theory and now it is consistent, so no problem. Now I will go to gap. I don't know if I am late or not. It's a very new one. So it's a Japanese mission. It's a very funny mission because it is put on the solar sail, Japanese solar sail. So, and it is at the center of the solar sail. It's a very small polar emitter and very good at polarization because it's in a geometric configuration which is very profitable for this, with CSI crystal and plastic around it. So, in that configuration, when you have a Compton scatter, nearly all the angles are looked by the other scatterer. The problem with Compton scattering is that you may miss event, in fact. If you are like that, if you have a Compton scattering, it can go elsewhere than your other detector. So the best way is to put a box around, but also this circular configuration is also a good way of doing so, and it is less weighty, less volumic, and so on and so forth. And they test it on ground in polarized beam to check for systematics. So that's the result they publish. I don't know how they... apparently, they computed using chi-square, which is maybe not a good thing. And they have 3 sigma detection here in the two intervals, different intervals of the GRB, this GRB. It was measured at quite high energy. And in fact, they found the same thing that integral, that is that the polarization angle, sorry, and fraction are variable during the GRB light curve. Voilà.
This is very different because this is not repeated, right?
No, because in fact, this I don't know exactly how they have done, but it is because, well, okay.
And furthermore, it looks like there's no signal on the first quantity, only at 2.
No, it's because it is non-uniform. If there is big non-uniformity in the detector, that is, even if you have no polarization, you will have some effect due to the non-uniformity. So here you have at the same time the non-uniformity and the polarization signal. So the polarization signal is indeed pi periodic, but non-uniformity modify it like that. And they try to modelize both at the same time. In fact, this grid was much more uniform in that sense. So a few words about the future mission for gamma ray burst polarimetry measurement. As Peter told you, there have been a lot of mission which has been conceived to measure polarization, Compton telescope, and a lot of them has not been selected. So I will not speak of them. You have CAPSIT, CRISP, and things. The only one now which survived, to my knowledge, is Polar. Maybe there is another, if you know, but it's the only one I know. And Polar is a true Compton telescope, and also it is dedicated to gamma ray burst polarization measurement, so it's exactly what you want, what you wish. And it's a Swiss-led mission, and it is foreseen to be placed on the Chinese space station, Tiangong 2, in 2014. They are in the way to make the qualification model, so it's running smoothly. And it is very simple in conception, in the design. It's a plastic bar, plastic scintillator bar, which is there. In fact, it's a 8x8 scintillator bar, which are read by a multi-anode photomultiplier, and you have a front-end electronic. And in fact, you can have the X and Y position of the interaction by the number of the bar. Each bar gives you the X and Y. And if you read at the bottom and on the top, you can have an idea of the Z of the interaction as in a time of flight, classical time of flight experiment in particle physics. There is time of flight experiment in particle physics made with plastic scintillator and two detectors. And by looking at the difference between the two signals, you have the Z. So here you have this. And it is a good configuration because it can obtain up to 60% of modulation. Voilà, voilà. So this is foreseen for 2014. And to my knowledge, it's the only future gamma ray burst polarization or only polarization mission which is existing. There are other missions, of course, which are existing in hard X-ray or soft gamma ray, but which are not dedicated to polarization, but which can do polarization.
How sensitive would be this? How sensitive would be this? Polar is it going to be only sensitive to the very brightest bar?
No, they sell it at... I will have to check, but they sell it as to be quite sensitive because they want to see, I don't know, such as 50 bursts a year or things like that.
How many, sorry?
50 or 60 they sell. They sell.
It looks like it's about 900%,
right? It doesn't play that easily in
scale. Well,
there's a question
of the radiation.
The
900,
that's pretty good, right?
The advantage of this is it's a 2π emission, so you have a 2π field of view. But effectively, I think that we have not much information about this, but the low threshold should be not very low. So we have a future mission that I have divided in three types: the future Compton telescope, future X-ray focusing, and future coded mask. And of course, the next future Compton telescope is in Astro H, because there is a Compton telescope in Astro H. In 2014, there is four instruments, in fact, in Astro H. You have a soft X-ray calorimeter, you have a soft X-ray imager, you have a soft hard X-ray imager, and the HGD, which is a Compton here camera. You see here that it is a double strip detector of silicon and CDT, cadmium telluride, and it is protected by a BGO shield. And they made some measurement on ground, and it shows very good polarimetric result. It works very well. They made also some measurement of Compton imaging for medical study, for instance, with this camera, and they can image a source, oui.
That telescope is pointed, or
No, I will tell you about that in a few seconds. Just wait a bit. Well, they use this Compton camera, for instance, for medical imaging. They can pinpoint some radioactive element in a PET or in things like that. And the problem is what you said, in fact, is that this instrument is pointing in a way. It has a large field of view as any Compton telescope, but for the need of astro-age, they restrain it. For us, it's not so good, but okay, to the field of view of the other imaging system on board astro-age. So the field of view is only 10 degrees, which is, it is restrained by a very long collimator in a BGO. So you have to go to high energy to pass through this BGO. So it is something which is pointing and which may have some kind of, say, pi field of view, but above 200 or 300 kV. Below, it has this big collimator which stops any emission from after 10 degrees. That's a pity for gamma ray burst.
But 10 degrees
is very small. Oui, it's what I said. So, and in fact, if you go even below, because this detector can go down to a few tenths of a kV, they have another fine collimator made in passive material here, which restricts the field of view again to 0.5 degrees. So, for next focusing telescope is New Star. You all heard about it previously. So it will be launched soon. I don't know if you have some news now, but voilà. So it's a focusing telescope. It's the first one which focuses hard X-ray with a hard X-ray graded mirror, which is which focus X-ray toward the CZT matrices. In fact, four CZT matrices, 12 meters away. In fact, there is some study in the New Star team to make some polarization measurement with New Star using the fact that you can measure 90 degree polarization. But again, there is a very small field of view because it's a focusing instrument, so it will never see gamma ray burst more. It will be good to measure polarization of maybe X-ray binaries or pulsars, but not gamma ray burst. And then you have the long list of future wide field imager with coded mask. So there is AstroSat, which is Indian. We have UFO 100, but I put some, but there is more than Russian, Korean, American, than French people also in UFO, I think. And SVOB. So all these wide field imager can be used also as a 90 degree polarimeter, except maybe Eclair, which is here in SVOB. Because for the moment, and that's it's a pity also, they have not enough telemetry and they are obliged to remove all the multiple events. So they kept only the single one. So that's I have already discussed with them to try to get it back, but it seems difficult. Okay, so that's my conclusion. Well, as you can imagine, measurement of polarization is a powerful tool to investigate emission mechanism and geometry of gamma ray bursts. I have not been into the theory because I am not a theorist. You can also address some fundamental physics question, and we will have some next generation polarimeter, but which maybe not will not maybe what we want. So there is around the world several Compton telescope already projects to find out a better solution for a Compton telescope or polarimeter. Thank you.